Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to this session called Climate Action in the Post-Paris COP21 World, Intersections with International Trade. My name is Ingrid Jegot. I'm a senior manager in ICTSD, where I manage our program on climate change and clean energy. And this session is co-organized between ICTSD and SOTI, South Asia Watch on Trade, Economics and Environment, represented here today by the Executive Director Hiramani Gimire. So when we started planning this session a few months ago, we were still in the preparations of COP21, not really knowing what to expect. I mean, we were all hopeful, I think, but I don't think that we could really expect the quite successful outcome that we actually saw last week. On the other hand, we had quite high expectations on the environmental goods agreement, which is being negotiated. And unfortunately, I think it looks like we will have to wait a bit longer before we see a successful outcome of that agreement, but it has been making good progress in Geneva. But what we wanted to do was to have a discussion about the trade and climate change interlinkages, because we knew that going into Paris, we were going to see a future with much broader climate change action, because all the parties to the UNFCCC are now expected to actually undertake climate action, which is a big change compared to the previous system we had, where only a list of developed countries actually had binding commitments to address climate change. And so now we see a much broader response to climate change with a broader diversity of measures that are going to be implemented to address climate change. And that also means that there are possible trade implications. That we don't exactly know yet which instruments are that the countries are going to use, but we can expect a mix of incentives to scale up clean energy, climate-friendly goods, and as well as taxes and so on more polluting activities. And all of this may have an impact on consumption and production patterns, transport, competitiveness, and of course on trade. We have already seen in the WTO a few cases emerging that are relevant to climate policies. And for those of you who attended a session that we did earlier this morning on clean energy and climate change, we also heard about the important surge in anti-dumping cases where there's an over-representation in the area of clean energy, and also the increasing number of local content requirements, which is also an effect of climate policies. So we see that this intersection between trade and climate change is increasingly present, and we foresee that this is going to continue to develop over time. So today we have a panel of speakers. It's a mix of some of the foremost experts on these interlinkages, as well as delegates from the WTO who very generously have made time out of their busy agenda over at the KICC. So I already introduced briefly Hiramani Gimire, who will be the first speaker. And then to his left, we have David Runnels, who is the chairman of the board of ICTSD, as well as the senior fellow with the Center for International Governance Innovation. To his left, we have Thomas Brewer, senior fellow of ICTSD. And I should mention a member of the IPCC as well. And now just arriving into the room, Jean-Paul Tullier, permanent representative of France to the WTO. And on my right-hand side, Alvaro Cedeño, ambassador for Costa Rica to the WTO in Geneva. Welcome, Jean-Paul. I know that you have a very busy schedule. Would you like to go first so that you can rush off? Or? Yeah. Okay, in that case, the floor is yours.
Yes, thank you very much, Ingrid. And first of all, thank you for all to be here. It's really cold here right now. I wanted, as a representative of France, to be here this afternoon for this seminar organized by Ingrid, and I'm warmly thanking her thanking her for having organized this this event. And my purpose.
Okay, you don't see me otherwise. Okay, so my purpose was to talk about relationship or the lack of relationship between climate and trade under the title of the missing link, because actually, if you look at climate negotiations and the substance of those negotiations, you find three main pillars in the COP21 negotiation. The first being clearly the agreement itself, the second being the national strategies with the commitments taken by members, and the third being with the financial pillar of this agreement. And what is striking me as a trade guy is that trade is not the issue, was not an issue for this negotiation. Afterwards, commentators mainly identified some gaps or missing issues, let's say, for instance, oceans, maritime transport, air transport, which were not present in that negotiation, where there are a big issue for climate change. But no one referred to the lack of the trade aspect in that negotiation, and in itself, it calls for reflection. Precisely during the Paris conference, you had a lot of very big leaders, such as Bill Gates. And if you have noticed his statements and his press conference in Paris, he said precisely that free trade was not the issue for the climate negotiations, and so it calls for reflection for ourselves, because the question of relation between trade and environment is not a new one, to say the least. We have in the Marrakesh Agreement of the WTO very clear objective started by sustainable development, which encompasses the issue of climate. We have mandates to deal with global issues in relation to trade within the Marrakesh mandate. And so I think that we need collectively reflect on where and why and when this gap is so obvious, but which is not actually referred in the press, in the analysis, in the expert fora. Clearly, right now, we have the EGA negotiation, which is quite now famous for many of you. You know that up till now, negotiations are stuck, and I heard this morning that the chair, Amina Mohamed, called for an agreement or something like that in Nairobi, but clearly we won't get this kind of agreement. We see that right now the spectrum of this negotiation remains narrow based on the fact that for some political or tactical reasons, the US are reluctant to expand the scope of the EGA to the other dimensions of trade, which are services related to goods and to new technologies. And in substance, we think, we consider as the EU and as France, that the US have offensive interest, to say the word which is the keyword of trade negotiation. And behind those tactical reasons, we don't really understand why, in substance, the US should be reluctant to extend the scope of this EGA agreement, because as long as the scope is remaining very narrow, then clearly the vehicle of trade to help the fight against climate change will remain quite thin or small, and is not in accordance to the size of the challenge. And so, if I have three messages to pass on you today, the first would be that in terms of objective and direction, the first, we need to expand as much as possible and as early as possible the participation of AGA and the scope of this agreement. Clearly, COP21 agreement and all the side agreements which have been signed, starting by the Solar Alliance between India and some other stakeholder like France, will expand the spread of technologies and development of projects. And those are physically linked to trade. The second direction we need to get is to look as well at the acquis of the WTO, because right now we have focused mainly on this EGA agreement, which is a new issue. But still, we need to have a precise look on what the WTO can deliver in its present acquis. And I made a specific reference to the GPA agreement, because within the GPA agreement, you find not only a tool, a major tool for the financing of projects by states, and whatever the participation of the relevant stakeholders in development of projects, be it private, be it through public-private partnership, it will remain in the end, in many cases, funded by through public procurement, and then I think that we need to have a political review on that and see how, in complement to the revision of this agreement, which was adopted at MC8, we can further the climate dimension of public procurement and then see how not only to adapt the principles of the agreement, but as well to expand the scope of the offers of the commitments taken by the partners of this agreement. And as you know, this agreement is still a bilateral agreement with very slight expansion up to from the beginning. We have been recently receiving Australia and New Zealand and some others are at the door of this agreement, but still China is still lacking, and not talking about India. So second direction, second objective is to review the WTO agreement and see how they can help the trade side to be more related to climate strategies. And the third one, which may be the most important right now, is to get the relevant political signals from the leaders, starting by the ministers here in Nairobi, in having the possibility to address this issue specifically of climate and, broadly speaking, the new issues as a whole. Because in the end, not only we will be able to use trade as a perfect tool for enhancing public policies fighting against climate change, but as well we will have to reflect on the global scope of and strategies members of the WTO have to think about and to adopt. One specific point, and I will conclude by that, not being too long, and referring back to Bill Gates' agreement on free trade. Clearly, when you look at the main features of this agreement and the relevant interest between developed members, developing members, and the rest, we'll have to make an arbitration between free trade on one side and the development of local technologies on local industries, on local services, and see how developed members, for instance, may help developing members to get into that direction. Otherwise, my belief is that a national strategy will fail if there is no sufficient appropriateness. But when it comes to establish a balance between free trade and national interest and capacity through transfer of technology or whatever, some members, developing member states to be able to develop their own national markets and all national technologies and sector, then we will have to discuss further at the WTO on how to create this right balance. So that's how that's the messages I wanted to pass on to you, ending up to say only that it's on a personal basis that I'm doing so, and this is not at all reflecting some kind of follow-up French policy thinking after the COP21 conference. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Jean-Paul. Those were very constructive ideas, I think, of how the trade system could reflect on climate action. I don't know how much in a hurry you are. Would you have time to stay around for a little while? Can we? Would you have time for a few questions? Or
yes, right now I have half an hour. It's quite. It's not so tight. We have a meeting at 6:30.
Okay. Well, in that case, I think we will move on to our next speaker. And then before you have to leave, we'll open up for a few questions. So I would like to give the floor to Dr. Guy Miret, who is the co-organizer of this session. So the floor is yours, please.
Thanks, Ingrid. my presentation complements, basically, your presentation. And would be speaking also about the relationship linked between climate change and trade. That's also the title of our discussion today, intersections between climate change and trade issues. Briefly, I would be handling three questions. One is, how are trade issues linked to climate change issues? How has the response been on the part of the international trade regime, especially WTO, on climate change issues? And finally, if there are any gaps in terms of the response, what can be done in the future to have a better climate governance? So basically, three areas. On the first question, does trade have anything with climate change? Of course, yes, because any trade transaction has some production processes behind it. And these production processes are associated with emissions, and that has implications for climate change. That's the question. And there has been a study by IPCC which says, economy-wise, there are a number of activities responsible for climate change in different ways. For example, the production of electricity, for example, accounts for 25% of total global emissions. Agriculture in the second place, 24%. Transport, 14%. Industry, 21% accounts for global emissions. So there are different types of economic activities that have implications on climate change. So they influence climate change differently. Also, the impact of trade in climate change is depends on basically three factors. One is the scale of economic operations, the scale of output, business, and so on. The second is composition of trade. What area are you focusing on? Some of the sectors are more energy intensive, some others are less so. So the composition of sectors is important. And finally, the technique is important. Which techniques are you employing in the production processes and so on? So the overall impact depends on the magnitude and strength of each of these factors, scale, composition, and technique. But the crucially important factor among these three is, I think, technique, because on scale, everybody wants to produce more, and there is no question of going back in terms of production, and that's the incentives of countries. And composition is a question of comparative advantage, so countries have comparative advantage in some sectors, so they want to do their sectors. So there is not much scope in terms of doing anything. On technique, you can do much. How do you produce? What technology you employ? How much a sector is energy intensive? And so on. So this is one crucial factor that the trade regime, and so the climate change regime, would be able to influence the agenda. And therefore, this leads to my second question. So how is the international trade regime responding to the question of technique then? I am focusing on the technique side of the three factors. In two ways. One is just covered, liberalizing the trade in environmental goods, the EGA. Environmental goods, as we all know, account for 4% of total global trade, amounting to $1 trillion. It has started, the negotiations have started in a plurilateral way, but I think other countries may be covered in later negotiations. And you have already mentioned that the expansion and coverage of other countries is important. I think that will go ahead. This is also an area for some concrete results, because on environmental goods, we have now tariff rates as high as 35%. So if we could bring these tariff rates down, then we could see some concrete results. But there are also some challenges. For example, the very question of definition of environmental goods is yet being discussed. What are environmental goods? Especially, there are some environmental goods which can be recognized, but there are some processes which might be helping the environmental cause. For example, in environmental goods versus a production process that employs climate-friendly technologies. So how should we deal with that? So some of the definitional issues are there. What they are talking about now on environmental goods, you are trying to reduce tariffs, but the NGVs represent a big hurdle in this sector. And finally, the question of services, also briefly touched. The environmental trade is basically services, because services account for 65% of the industry. And unless you cover that, it's difficult to make concrete progress on that. So there are some challenges, but because the negotiations have started, and we hope that the expansion of the negotiation, both in terms of the coverage of countries, but also in terms of coverage of the areas, NTB services, et cetera, should also be thought through. The second question on the technique side is the important question of technology transfer, especially for developing countries. And in the WTO system, there are some provisions, there is some scope to promote technology transfer, because WTO system does provide IPRs, protection to intellectual property rights. But we know that too much of protection also can stifle innovation. So you have to see the degree and extent of the protection. So if it is too much, then it might be counterproductive to innovation. But also, the IPR-induced market power may be misused also. So again, WTO system should be able to avoid these two potential risks in the IPR regime. But when you look at the TRIPS agreement of the WTO, which provides IPR's protection, TRIPS does recognize these elements and has some provisions in the treaty itself. For example, there should be a balance between IPR protection and public interest, TRIPS Article 7. Also, misuse of TRIPS power, IPR power, should be avoided, Article 8. Technology transfer is mandated in the TRIPS agreement, Article 66.2. And there are some so-called TRIPS flexibilities, which may be used in favor of public health and biodiversity and other systems. So there is some scope to make the TRIPS agreement, to use it flexibly, especially in favor of some developed countries where the question of technology is so important. However, The performance so far has been rather poor because despite these agreements and so on, these provisions, not much use has been made out of, all these provisions. So developed countries still suffer from the lack of abilities in using technology. So, and there are also other, in the WTO system, there are also other rules beyond IPRs which have implications for climate change. For example, the question of subsidies. Developed countries pay a large amount of subsidies, including France. So even if it is not your government position, but you should see personally that the subsidies paid to French farmers or developed country farmers come at the cost of climate change. I refer to a data from IPCC in the beginning that agriculture forestry accounts for 24% of the global trade emissions. So, and if you pay or keep paying subsidies to farmers, then it may have implications for climate change also. But there are also the debate on agriculture subsidies is long. We have been talking about that. But there are some new issues also under the subsidies regime. For example, with the increasing trend of imposing carbon tax in some of these countries, whether, for example, countervailing measures could be applied in some cases, because some countries have imposed carbon tax, some others not. And in terms of the so-called border measures, in terms of trying to offset the implications of these carbon taxes, countries are trying to take resort to the WTO regime on subsidies and countervailing measures. So this is another area where we should be more clear about the implications of these subsidies. Then also there are rules on technical standards which might be applied in such a way that they may create problem to international trade. And on border issues, probably the climate change, the Paris Agreement will have one good thing about border measures, because after Copenhagen there was a tendency that because climate change agreement had collapsed at that time in Copenhagen, so the only option for developed country was to impose these border measures. But now with the Paris Agreement and with each country at least trying to take some measures against climate change, probably there would be no further stronger need for these border measures. So that's that should be seen as a good outcome. Now that's the problem, of especially of developed countries. My third question, what can be done about it? Many things to be done, but I am a pragmatist, so not much can be done, but there might be some steps which we can take now. 5 points, just I will brief. One, the question of technology transfer. I come back to this issue, which is so important in terms of protecting the climate, the earth. Technology transfer, and this should be, there should be a stronger commitment in terms of technology transfer. Because even the word technology transfer has not been defined adequately, I would say, because technology transfer means you have to be able to manufacture a product, but also you have to do to be able to apply a process, and by applying process you have also to be able to render a service, which means capacity building of the potential users of the technology is also a very important question. So you can't say that okay, technology, access to technology has been provided, but the whole question of capacity building to take benefit of this technology is comes into questions, and therefore we must have, as the Bali Action Plan says, measurable, verifiable, and these monitorable results in terms of technology. But capacity building is so important. It's not only important for climate change, it is important anyway. By not doing it in action in terms of technology transfer, capacity building, etc., means there is a risk of what they call in the climate change language carbon leakage, which means industries might be shifting to countries where weak regulated environment exists. So if you don't build the capacity of these countries, there will be a tendency among industries to shift to developing countries, and then again create problems, climate change, which doesn't recognize borders. Therefore, it's a question of whether to do now or to pay the cost later. Second, on the subsidies regime, I indicated we must reduce, eliminate basically subsidies and fossil fuels, but also agricultural subsidies should be reviewed. But the whole structure of subsidies should be reviewed because there will also be a need for allowing subsidies in green technologies, for example, climate-friendly technologies. The government, especially in developing countries, should be allowed some green space to take policy measures on these. So the whole question of where to stop, where to allow subsidies is emerging in the trade and climate change debate. Then on the EGA, as we indicated, both of us, the coverage, the expansion, and should be there. Services is important, but to be pragmatist again, it might be too early to move to the question of services agreement on environment, but I think the NTB should at least be covered. So the negotiations should at least cover. Still on environmental goods agreement, this is being held in this part of the world, in developed countries and so on, but developing countries are not at this stage in a position to immediately benefit from the EGA, so because they don't produce EGA, environmental goods, they will have to import them only at this stage. But if we do move towards the agreement, I think there will be another question of offering financial technical packages, technical and financial packages to developing countries so they can also be part of the, be motivated, incentivized to be part of the environmental agreement. So there should be a need for financial technical packages on that. On environmental goods. Government Procurement Act, I agree, because the government is a huge spender, is a big spender. Some 60% of budget goes on procurement, government public procurement, and how this should be aligned with the agenda of climate change, green technologies, and so on. So probably there should be a need for some adjustments in the GPA itself. And finally, the final point, we are now, at least in my presentation, talked about WTO and the different agreements under the WTO. But the WTO itself now is being influenced by some other agreements that have been taking place outside of the WTO. TPP, an example. TPPIP is coming, and some other agreements. TISA, services agreement. So some of these agreements, regardless of what the WTO system does or doesn't do, some of the agreements are already having provisions that may have implications for climate change. For example, under the TPP, the trade between Europe and the USA or many other countries, I think it is Japan on the TPP, Japan, USA, etc., the goods covered by these agreements, if the trade volume increases for these goods, that doesn't mean the trade is friendly to climate change, for example. So the many products are covered by the treaty, which might be questioned in terms of the climate change agenda. So we need to understand better some of these agreements that have been taking place outside the WTO, but still have implications for climate change. And they cannot be underestimated because in terms of their influence, because the 12 countries, for example, account for a large part of the global trade. And when TPIP is signed, another big agreement will happen. So they might be even more important than the WTO system. So we are still yet to understand better the implications of these agreements, which I think should be studied well. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much. I think we've heard two presentations that are very broad and complementary, and they have really set the context for our discussions here today, outlining the linkages between trade and climate change. So later on in this session, we're going to narrow in a bit more on the Paris outcome and on the trade implications of the Paris outcome, and then on the EGA. But I think what I would like to do now is to open up the floor for a couple of questions, focusing on this broader context of trade and climate change. If there are one or two questions, I would just like to ask you to please hold with any questions you may have on the EGA until we have heard from Ambassador Sedeño, because he's going to give us some more detail. So are there any questions or comments at this stage? Okay, well, we'll just save it for later then. So in that case, I would like to ask David Runnels to take the floor and to give us some insights on climate governance and the Paris outcome.
Well, thanks very much, Ingrid. As Ingrid mentioned before, I'm a Canadian. As you can see, I brought my climate with me. If you can envision, these walls look a little like snow, and all we really need is a polar bear so everybody will feel comfortable. But if you think it's cold in the audience, you should sit up here because this is where it's all coming from. So bear with us through our experiences with hypothermia. I want to say a few general things about the conference in Paris for those of you who weren't there, because it was a genuinely remarkable event. It might well have saved the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change process, and I think it renewed many people's hopes in multilateralism. There was a very open, very transparent process amongst 196 countries, which yielded up a unanimous result with real teeth. And I'm glad that Ambassador Trudier is still here, because the French government deserves an enormous amount of credit for organizing something 2 weeks after a horrendous terrorist event that was as successful as it was. And it was a real tribute to both French diplomacy and meticulous preparation, and particularly the endless patience and diplomatic skill of Laurent Fabius, who's the French foreign minister, who saw and spoke to everybody. There wasn't a single delegation that felt that it hadn't had a chance to have its say. And our old friend Laurence Toubiana, who is the founder of an institute which has worked very closely with ICTSD in the past. So it wasn't just that, but it did prove that you can have a very complex discussion. And I can tell you that these discussions are at least as complicated as any trade negotiations amongst 196 countries in a pretty open setting, and still have a result. It is a legal and binding agreement. It doesn't have binding obligations in the sense of national targets, but it does have targets which are legally binding. And in fact, the target now has been reduced below the Copenhagen target to less than 2 degrees C and as close as possible to 1.5 degrees C. That's a major change. That is a binding commitment. There is a regular stock taking every 5 years. There are requirements for ratcheting up national contributions every 5 years. And there's a regime, a very strict regime, for monitoring and reporting and verification. So when you report your results, they'll be subject to peer review. And the hope is that as countries progress, this review process will stimulate further reductions in their greenhouse gas emissions. There's a section that deals with funding for developing countries. There's not enough money, but there's a substantial amount. It's $100 billion a year. And there's finally a good and decent section on adaptation. And that would be of interest to those of you involved from Southeast Asia and Africa as well. I think they're getting better at dealing with adaptation. Adaptation is difficult to negotiate. For those of you who are trade negotiators, mitigation is fairly simple. You do this and I'll do that. Adaptation can't be negotiated in quite the same way, and it's hugely expensive. But I think there's now a realization that adaptation is a very major challenge. I also want to point out that there were two major initiatives that came from developing countries. And most of the time in climate negotiations, the G77 in China has been in a reactive position. In this case, they weren't. The first is what was called the High Ambition Alliance, started by the Marshall Islands, population 52,000. And by the end of the conference, it included the United States, the EU, Canada, and another 100 countries or so. And if you looked in the hall, all of the delegates were wearing these little pieces of jewelry made of coconut husk, handed out by the Marshall Islands delegation. So from those of you from small countries who think you have very little, if any, influence on a major negotiation, This was a very illuminating thing. This is what reduced the targets to below 2 and hopefully to 1.5, because the Marshall Islands will literally be underwater at plus 2 degrees centigrade because of sea level rise. Second major initiative was an initiative taken by the Indian government, in fact, in Mr. Modi's opening speech, which is an international solar alliance of more than 120 countries with a secretariat in Delhi. Now, I must say, I work for the Center for International Governance Innovation, and this bears a striking resemblance to a paper prepared for us by Arunabha Ghosh of the Center for Energy, Environment, and Water, who is also a member of the board of ICTSD. He also suggested an alliance on high-tech R&D and its dissemination, and that resulted in 20 countries, including Canada, pledging to double their spending on research and development on clean tech. And Bill Gates, as Mr. Gamir referred to initially as well, came along with a bunch of billionaires and offered to take this technology developed by governments and begin to commercialize it. So there was a very interesting discussion about clean technology there. And finally, I should say that I found the side events. There were lots of events like this one, and they're huge. I mean, there must have been 1,000 side events in Paris on virtually every subject run by virtually every country. In some ways, more interesting than the actual negotiations. And I followed the side events involving investors with considerable interest. And there were long discussions by institutional investors, big pension plans, insurance companies and the like, about the risks involved now in investing in high carbon investments, the danger of stranded assets with large investments in oil companies, and a real sort of feel for the fact that they now have to begin to find ways to invest in a future which is less dependent on carbon, and I thought was really quite interesting. Now, let me just reflect a little bit. I have 5 things just to say about what this might mean for development, and I think for South Asia in particular, and this is for everybody. There's a real need here for policy coherence. This has been quite a good year for the UN, the Sendai conference on disaster relief, the Addis Ababa conference on financing for development, the Sustainable Development Goals, and now Paris. All of these had the potential to create a poisonous north-south atmosphere, and none of them did. How do we integrate these insights now into a new concept of development and poverty alleviation? We have these goals. We now have a need to do something serious about climate change. We have some money, and we have some sense of what a low-carbon future might look like. How does this actually contribute to a new view of development and poverty alleviation? There are trade implications, and the other speakers are going to speak more than I on these. But do bear in mind that the Paris Agreement is not just an environmental agreement. It's essentially an investment agreement. It's really about persuading large pools of capital to invest in a different kind of future in developed and developing countries. That in itself has some implications for the WTO. I'd also watch for the creation of things called climate clubs. Tom is going to, I think, probably talk about this a bit, but the idea being it's a voluntary association of countries that will collaborate on something, for example, on carbon pricing. Carbon pricing and emissions trading are actually in the Paris Agreement, so they're governed by that, but there will be an attempt by a number of countries, I think, to form associations, informal or formal, on carbon pricing. And that will raise the whole question of what do you do about free riders, what do you do about taxes at the border, and so on. I think those will be a real concern for the WTO. I think one should also bear in mind that this is a real opportunities agenda. This is not you can't do this and you can't do that. It's you should do these other things. The paper which Dr. Ghosh wrote, which is on our website, explores the options for establishing international technology partnerships for small-scale, village-level, renewable energy technologies. So how do you help to redefine poverty alleviation as a product of a shift to a lower carbon technology? real opportunities to get rid of fossil fuel subsidies. Mr. Gamiri mentioned that. But what's happening is that the vast majority of direct subsidies are actually provided by developing countries and their consumer subsidies. The Indian government has wisely removed the subsidy on diesel because of the collapse in oil prices, saving $10 billion. The Indonesian government has begun to dismantle a lot of its fuel subsidies, which ate up a third of the Indonesian budget as recently as 3 or 4 years ago. So there's a real possibility there to get rid of these subsidies and to try and resist the temptation to put them back on again if the price rises. Another interesting issue for the trade community. India is really the key to the success of the Paris Agreement. China is within sight of stabilizing its greenhouse gas emissions. China has probably reached peak coal consumption already. There was another study we commissioned by a group in China that said that last year China's coal consumption dropped, and it's dropped again this year. And I think in its deal with the United States, the Chinese leadership is seriously under-promised. They will get to stabilization much before 2030. But the Chinese leadership is very cautious and doesn't like to make promises it can't keep. So that leaves India, which consumes less than half the energy per person of China, is going through a major industrialization push. And how the rest of the world deals with this in terms of funding and technology transfer, and how the Indian government deals with this may well determine the fate of the climate change agreement. So the implications for South Asia are very real here. Now, I just want to say one thing, and then I'm pretty much finished. And that is there's a real problem here, and there's always been a problem in the climate negotiations of being left behind. Mitigation, particularly, is an arithmetical exercise. Six countries plus the European Union produce 85% of the world's greenhouse gas emissions. That means that the other 130 or 140 countries collectively produce about 15%. And it's very important to keep the focus in these negotiations on things other than just mitigation. And that means adaptation, it means compensation for loss and damage, and it really genuinely means how to redefine development so that it delivers poverty alleviation, reasonable food production, and the rest, while at the same time releasing people from energy poverty. These things are probably possible, but they're going to require major real reorientation of the way in which we do development strategies. Christine Lagarde and Jim Kim, the president of the World Bank, and Angel Gurria, the secretary general of the OECD, all said, without prompting, that they think that climate change is the major economic issue facing the world in the 21st century. So this is not an environmental thing. It's not just something for rich countries to fuss about in their spare time. This is a real economic challenge, and it's a real set of economic opportunities as well. Last year, we got to the stage where the investment in renewable energy sources was about at the same level, according to the IEA, as the investment in fossil fuel sources. That's an enormous change, and it's where the smart money's going. So this could be a very, very interesting and really rather exciting future. But those of you who deal with the trading system can see endless amounts of both possibilities of environmental goods liberalization and so on, and there are endless potential conflicts. So I'll finish by saying that I had a long chat with Tim Grosser, who some of you will know, who's been both the New Zealand ambassador to the WTO and the foreign minister and was very active in the negotiations in Paris. And we talked about this question of the mutual understanding between the two regimes, and he said, I reckon there probably are 25 or 30 people in this room of whatever, 1,000 delegates, who actually understand both sides of this equation. So I think there really is an urgent need to create both a policy level and a technical level dialogue between the climate change regime and the trade regime. So that's my bet. Thank you.
Okay, thanks a lot, David. Those were really very important insights, I think, that you shared with us. I'd just like to comment on one of the things you said. You mentioned the side events that were interesting. And I would just like to add to that that something that was interesting in the area of side events was that there were actually, for the first time since I started going to the COPs in 2009, several side events on trade, because usually it's ICTSD organizing the side events on trade. But now there were several of them, and they were looking at the potential of trade to contribute to climate action. So there was this very positive approach to trade. And normally what we are used to seeing in the climate context is more of a focus on the fears for green protectionism, as mentioned by Dr. Gimiri, border carbon adjustment and so on. And there is usually a reference being made by a group of developing countries to unilateral measures, which is a fear that there would be trade barriers raised against developing countries. So that was really an interesting development. Would you like to make a few comments?
Yes. Only to say that I must leave right now and say only that I do concur with most of the analysis and points made there. By the two speakers, Dr. Yoramani Gimir and Mr. Thomas Brewer, on their respective points, saying as well that we are grateful for the kind words about the COP22 and Paris Agreement and the way it was done in Paris. But as I used to say right now to the ambassador and ministers to whom I'm talking about that in the WTO context of an Arabic conference, it's not a French success, it's a success for France, technically speaking, in terms of diplomacy, but it's 196 parties who agreed, and it's a real, it was a real challenge, but still it means that the international community and multilateralism are strong when they are facing real global issues, and this is a real global issue. And to end by that, in relation to trade, environment, WTO, and UNFCCC, you talked about a new agreement which was as well including trade and investment dimension. I would be, as I'm French, more conceptual, speaking about the emerging of a new international legal and judicial order which has to be confronted with and combined with the WTO, and that's the real challenge we have to address tomorrow in 2016 at the WTO after Nairobi. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much for making it today in spite of your commitments over at the KICC. So, Tom, the floor is yours.
Thank you. I wanted to echo David's two introductory comments, actually. And the first one, again, is an expression of gratitude to the government of France, which I'm able to offer just in time as the ambassador is leaving. I have been to 12 COPs. This was by far the best organized, the best implemented, the most intelligently managed, if I can use that word, in the 12 that I've witnessed. So thank you. The second one, David's second introductory observation about the COP itself and the result was that it's genuinely remarkable, and I think that's a good summary. What I'm going to do is put the COP agreement in a broader context, and I'm going to really focus on the institutional landscape post-COP, post-Paris, and relate that to the trade institutional landscape and state a few highlights with a focus really on the climate change regime. And then I will conclude quickly with a example of a club that I've been working on. And then we will move on. Both the trade regime and the climate regime are highly fragmented. They're increasingly fragmented. They are what I like to refer to a little bit more positively, two processes that are pluralistic and that are engaged in adaptive learning. The climate regime has to some extent actually followed the trade regime in expanding and developing increasingly diverse institutional modalities. And the two are in many ways really quite strikingly similar. Both still have core multilateral institutions. Their relationships with all these many other elements of diverse types are sometimes complicated, sometimes ambiguous, sometimes a bit contentious. In the case of the climate regime, there's still a great deal of learning and coordination and coherence to be established. But the fact is we're really dealing with two enormously complicated and increasingly complicated regime complexes, is a term that some academics are using these days, especially in the U.S. There has been a kind of additional push in the direction in the climate regime of greater activity outside the multilateral core. And in fact, the agreements reached just last week include, I'm going to just read very quickly a couple of paragraphs. One is that the COP welcomes the efforts of all non-party stakeholders, to address and respond, sorry, my computer's doing a trick on me here, to address and respond to climate change, including those of civil society, the private sector, financial institutions, cities, and other subnational authorities. So there's an explicit recognition here of a whole bunch of actors other than national governments, or I should say in addition to national governments. Also, there's another paragraph that recognizes the important role of providing incentives for emission reduction activities, including tools such as domestic policies and carbon pricing. So there's explicit recognition that domestic policies and also carbon pricing especially are part of the toolkit now. That's been sort of officially recognized by the FCCC. Let me explain just a little bit more, a few highlights of this climate change regime complex. The FCCC is, I really just sort of saw this morning. It's a kind of paradox. It's a hybrid organization that is both unilateralist and universalist. And I say unilateralist because the INDCs, the intended nationally determined contributions, were a result, and there are over 180 some of them now, they're a result of individual countries' own initiative in figuring out what they wanted to do and what they were willing to say publicly they would try to do, notice intended, that they would try to do over the next couple of decades or so. So in that sense, it's really a unilateralist effort, but at the same time, as has already been pointed out, there are 196 signatories, and so that makes it a virtually universalistic agreement at the same time. There are a whole lot of other organizations that are climate change organizations, at least in part. We have international regional organizations. The EU emissions trading system is the most obvious example of that. We have transnational, subnational arrangements, such as the one between the state of California and two provinces of Canada, namely Quebec and Ontario. We have subnational regional arrangements such as the REGI in the United States, in the northeastern part of the country, which have established a cap and trade system, rather limited but still significant. We have sectoral organizations, the ICAO, International Civil Aviation Organization, and the IMO, the International Maritime Organization, are specifically, I don't know that delegated is legalistically quite the right word, but have been recognized as the two institutions to deal with the two major international transport sectors. We have lots and lots of bilateral arrangements, the most conspicuous recent ones being one between China and the U.S., another one between China and the EU. So what we have is really an enormously diverse array of institutions which collectively pose quite a problem for the trade community. It's no longer an issue between the WTO and the FCCC, issues which have not been resolved, which we've already heard in many cases. There are many, many, many opportunities, and I would certainly echo Ingrid's comments about the focus on opportunities that trade gives to enhance efforts to address climate change. Added to all that complexity is a both new and old idea. It's called clubs, climate clubs in particular. In the past 6 months, there's been a huge increase in interest in it, at least among a very small number of people. And we even have the World Bank now working on an initiative to create a network of carbon market clubs. It's still an initiative very much in early stages. You may hear a lot about it over the next few months and several years. But it's an indication that the notion of clubs is actually getting pretty high-level serious attention. I'm going to conclude rather immodestly with an example which I've been working on. It's an Arctic black carbon agreement. Since most of you are not climate change people, I have to explain black carbon is particulate matter, not a gas. Therefore, it is not covered by the FCCC, a very interesting gap. It is nevertheless the second leading contributor to global warming after carbon dioxide. It is a particularly pernicious problem in the Arctic, where the rate of global warming has been twice that of the world in general over the past decade or so. Some, but not all, of the black carbon emissions in the Arctic region come from international maritime shipping. So my proposal is a club which would address this particular problem. It's a club because it's a potentially relatively small number of countries. There are eight in the Arctic Council, which would presumably be the core, but it could grow to be over 100 or so. It could include non-governmental as well as governmental entities. It is both a energy technology sharing club and a emissions regulatory club, and there would be benefits of membership. There would be penalties for non-compliance. We don't need to go into the details. There is an ICTSD paper available. It's online. Was just finished a couple of months ago. There is some interest, particularly in the Nordic countries in the idea. The U.S. government may be interested. We'll see. But it's an example of a club that has both climate change and trade aspects to it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Tom. So I think that there will be lots of questions and comments on what you presented, because they're very interesting ideas, and the ABC agreement is really innovative, and I hope we'll have a chance to discuss that as well. But now I would like to invite Ambassador Alvaro Cedeño, to speak about the EGA finally, because I think that we have been, you know, touching upon it but not really going into depth yet. We have heard from all the panelists almost that the EGA is a tool to promote climate action, a trade tool to promote climate action, but we also heard that the development benefits are not clear. So I hope and I think that you would want to elaborate on both those issues.
Thank you very much, and asante sana, all of you, for being here. I liked very much the concept of a climate club on the Arctic. I personally lived in the Arctic for 2 years, and I am very sensitive to anything related to the Arctic, especially how cold it is up here. So, exactly, that's great, and I appreciate it. I also want to start on a similar note as my colleague, the French ambassador, said at the end of his introductory remarks. These are my personal opinions, so I hope I don't get in trouble with my government, so please help me to keep it that way. And then I would like to mention briefly about Costa Rica's understanding of the relation between trade and environment. 20 years ago, my government presented a proposal when the WTO was in its first days, literally, to bring the discussion of the linkages between trade and environment, which were critical for us and were almost a way of living in the 80s and early 90s. But unfortunately, that was not the right timing to do it. An interesting fact is that the president of Costa Rica at the time is the brother of Cristiana Figueres, and the father of both of them abolished our military army 67 years ago. So these people are up to great things. Okay, I'm not as eloquent and as knowledgeable as my fellow presenters here, so I do need to use a lot of my notes, and I apologize for that. Very briefly, to start off with the Environmental Goods Agreement, or EGA. It is a plurilateral agreement within the WTO that was launched last year, 2014, initially by a group of 14 countries, and later incorporated three more, with the intention to reach a critical mass of environmental goods trade in order to meet a non-regulatory requirement in the WTO of having somewhere between 85 or 90% of global trade in a particular industry in order to reach a plurilateral agreement that is later on going to be multilateralized through a most favored nation principle in the WTO. And Costa Rica joined the EGA from its very beginning, in part because we had gone through a very successful experience when we joined the Information Technologies Agreement almost 20 years ago. Back in 1996, when the ITA was negotiated, Costa Rica was not really an exporter of electronics. Our exports on electronics were about 3% of our total exports. But we saw an opportunity entering the ITA and attracting to our country foreign investment that would manufacture and develop technologies that would later be exported within our network of trade partners that has actually increased this list of trade partners over the years, to the point that by 2014, in a span of 18 years, our electronics exports had represented 23% of our foreign trade. So we were a very interesting case study for how a country that was not a producer, a manufacturer of a particular good, attracted the industry based on a legal framework that was offered by the WTO. And well, that is the motivation for Costa Rica to aspire to do the same with environmental goods. With an additional strength that we have, which is that we are almost reaching 100% of renewable electricity in our country. So anything that is manufactured in Costa Rica is most likely manufactured 100% with renewable energy. It means that if a product is intended to be friendly with the environment by reducing its ecological footprint, it would reduce it even more if it is manufactured in Costa Rica just because of the source of the electricity or the source of the energy. So in that sense, we are being strategic, thinking about where things could go. I think it was mentioned before, the percentage of what the EGA represents in terms of trade, the figure that we use is about $1.4 trillion in worth in trade. So if we could get a very small slice of that pie, that would be very significant for a small country with a small population as Costa Rica. And well, more in particular about the EGA and its categorization, there is still a little bit of a gray zone regarding definitions and what is an environmental good. Is it a good that will reduce emissions, that will be environment friendly, that saves energy, that saves water? It is unclear. But I think what is clear is the mandate that we are looking for a collection of these goods to try to promote their development, their innovation into the future, and of course their scaling up to other markets and other regions through a multilateral trade regime, which is the aspiration. So the initial list of goods that were in the EGA was about 650, and now it's gone down to 360 as of the last round, 363 to be more precise. And there was also another aspiration to try to complete it by the ministerial conference here in Nairobi. Unfortunately, it's not going to happen, but this doesn't mean that it's not going to happen at all. It's just not going to happen here. The momentum of COP21 was ideal, as it only ended last week. Unfortunately, the pace of negotiation requires a few more months. So I am hopeful that probably sometime in the first half of next year, we will be able to make an announcement about its success. Costa Rica is the only Latin American country involved in the EGA negotiations, and I think Ricardo mentioned in the morning that it is also the only developing country. I'm not sure about that.
I think there's also China.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Okay, so small developing. Okay. Without an army.
that's a very exclusive point.
Okay, so what the EGA aspires to do is to develop a legal and political platform to enter into a new era of a world economy. What was mentioned earlier here in this panel, that the COP is not as much a climate agreement as it is an investment agreement. I would say the EGA is not a traditional trade agreement. It's a trade agreement that is looking into the future of what a low carbon economy might look like. And this, we're talking 15, 20, 25 years down the road. So this is the time to start thinking and making decisions and planning for that future. Also, I would like to say that Costa Rica has become an illustration about green growth. And green growth is a concept that the WTO has incorporated, at least in mention, and more so at the OECD since 2011, as a new economic model that looks for a development that is more in harmony with nature. And in the last 25 years, Costa Rica has been very successful, opening, lowering its trade barriers, opening new markets, setting up trade agreements, seizing opportunities from the WTO regime. And our economy in the last 25 years has grown three times. And in the same process, in the same 25 years, our forest coverage has doubled. So in that sense, we could say that Costa Rica has been a country that has grown economically and has grown ecologically in parallel. So I like to refer to this process as regenerative development. It's a kind of development that has enriched nature in the process. So being a tropical country, and I think there are many things that we could say to tropical countries about green growth, especially because tropical countries amount for most of the rainforests in the world, which means most of the clean water, most of the fertile soil, most of the richest lands for production of food, and this is the planet's natural capital. So this natural capital must not only be preserved, it must also be recovered, because we have lost some in the process and we continue to lose some in the process. And at the same time, we could monetize it and identify opportunities and industries that would allow us to grow economically and grow ecologically in parallel. So obviously ecological tourism is one of our most important assets in terms of green industry. Renewable energies as well. It is nothing new for us. We started generating renewable energy 60 years ago, and that's why we are nearly reaching 100%. But the process won't stop once we reach 100, because from there you can already export clean energy, or you can use the clean energy to attract energy-intensive manufacturing for green goods, and I'm thinking here low-emissions automobiles, for example, which we don't manufacture, but we could, using clean energy, and in that sense, having a bigger impact in the production chain of green goods. Costa Rica launched 8 years ago an initiative to become a carbon-neutral country by 2021. Things got complicated when we had to draft our INDC this year, because we realized that it was not enough to measure how much carbon your forests sink in or sequester and how much your electricity matrix is already from renewable sources, because we have a big problem with transport. We need to upgrade our transport to make it cleaner, and that is not only a problem that Costa Rica has, but many other countries in the world face it. We believe that there is going to be a technology shift very soon, solar, batteries, electric cars, and we need to be part of that process in order to reduce the overall carbon footprint of our economy. So we are not only hopeful, we are also setting ambitious goals to try to achieve that. And then the EGA is a very important link in that process for us as we aspire to become successful doing the same thing we did with electronics 20 years ago. We would like to do the same with environmental goods as we move along into the future. We see that there are some technological innovations that might disrupt policy regulations. And in particular, I'm thinking about generation of renewable energy from solar sources. If you are able to generate your own electricity, why would you buy it from someone else? And when generating your own electricity becomes as inexpensive as having a smartphone, then most likely there is going to be a surplus in energy and a reduction in the cost of energy and a reduction in the carbon footprint of energy generation. Probably that's going to trigger development of more sophisticated and cheaper and more efficient batteries as well. So there is a virtuous cycle or a virtuous spiral that has definitely started already, and we see it coming, and we definitely want to be a part of that. So I guess I covered most of what I wanted to say. I'm a little bit over time, I just realized. I'm sorry for that, and thank you for listening. Sante sana.
Is this on? Yes. So I just have to disagree with you on one point, and that is that you would not be an eloquent speaker. I think you're a fantastic speaker, and that Costa Rica is a very inspiring case. So thank you so much for making time. I would like to open the floor now for a few questions or comments. Yes, please, over there and over there and in the back of the room. So three questions and comments, and then we'll close. Do we have a microphone? Yes. So to the lady over here, please.
My name is Marie-Louise Jambo-Müller. I'm from the Danish NGO, the Initiative for Trade and Development. And I appreciate all your talk about how climate change and trade interact, and that's all pretty great. And I think it's a shame that the Environmental Goods Agreement is not finalized yet, but I'm looking forward to that. But I was actually thinking, Mr. Ambassador to the WTO, what else are you doing to integrate the SDG agenda into the WTO? What can be done? Because the EGA is one thing, but that's sort of, you know, that's only between some countries. But what can be done to do more for climate change, do more for sustainable development?
Okay, thank you. That was a very clear question. Thank you for that. And then we had a question in the back of the room.
Hi, I'm Natalie Jones from the University of Cambridge. I think this has been a very productive discussion, especially as has been acknowledged, the trade and climate communities don't really talk to each other enough. And I say this having come also straight from the Paris COP. I was there as a New Zealand youth delegate. And it's really striking to me how little climate change is being talked about over at the KICC. I mean, here we're talking about it, which is great. And it's just this cognitive dissonance. It astounds me on the part of all the governments, this really positive Paris Agreement and so little action here in Nairobi. I acknowledge the Environmental Goods Agreement. I would echo the first person who asked the question that, yeah, it's a start, but it's also not enough, much like the Paris Agreement, and I feel like more can be done, and I would like to echo that question. What else can be done? And I have one comment also, which is to the trade policy people in the room, please do everything you can on this. Please make climate a priority, because it's, and I say this as a young person, probably one of the only people in the room under age 25, it's our future, it's the future of every person on this earth to come, and it needs to be a priority, and we need to keep on talking about this as much as possible in the trade policy community and amongst the trade community. Thanks.
Thank you very much for that that call for action, and also for your question. And then we had the third question over here.
Thank you very much. My name is Aaron Wolf. I'm with the Southern and Eastern African Trade Information and Negotiations Institute. My question was briefly one of our panelists briefly talked about it, but I was hoping for a little bit more detail. And it's with respect to embodied carbon in trade. So following the implementation of a carbon tax in the province of British Columbia in Canada, there was a marked decline in the production of carbon-intensive goods, but it was essentially a substitution towards goods with embodied carbon from other countries. So what I'm hoping to get a little bit more clarity on is what flexibilities actually exist within the WTO to implement countervailing duties or other barriers or other activities that you can undertake to protect against that kind of shift in carbon from one carbon haven to another instead of actually reducing it overall.
Okay, thank you very much. I think your institute probably has a more complicated acronym than ours. So one of the few. Congratulations. Alvaro, would you like to go first?
Thank you very much, and thank you for the questions. In Nairobi, the WTO is in charge of doing two tasks. First, completing the previously accepted agenda 2 years ago in the last ministerial, so a lot of the work has to do with negotiating what is ongoing. And the second task is to decide what to do afterwards. So that's where there's a lot of space and a lot of mention about the SDGs, and they are recognized as UN goals that have been decided not very long, that trade has a role to play, and that there is an end date in mind. So even though there is no agreement yet, there is plenty mention, and there is not much adversity to setting that as a goal for our next 2 years of work. So that's good news. I can't tell you right now what that's going to look in the process, but it will be there most definitely. Yeah. Then regarding the call for action from the young lady in the back, I have a 2-year-old daughter, and I have a 100-year-old grandmother. So if my daughter is as long living as my grandma, she's going to be 87 at the turn of the century. So I have to make sure that the planet looks as good as it can by the time she's there. And not only her, but her children and probably her grandchildren. I'm not going to be here, but there will be people here. So I want to make sure that this is the best planet that can be. And I think about that every day, 24 hours a day, and it's part of my work as well in the WTO. So, yeah, a reason for hope.
Thank you very much. Tom?
There were some people there who actually were sort of sympathetic and knowledgeable about the other communities' activities.
There were people at both who were sympathetic and open-minded, but basically it was a pretty hostile and not really very mutually understanding meeting. In the 15 years, although there's still a lot to be learned both ways, there's been a huge improvement. So there's actually progress. Very quickly on embodied carbon, I don't really have an answer about the CVD question you asked specifically. However, there is a huge interest in the climate change community now about the problem of embedded carbon in trade. It is an issue on which one would hope and expect the WTO would actually at some point have something to say. Thank you very much. I'm getting a positive reaction. at least about my hope. There is a group in the Netherlands, ICTSD has been also somewhat involved in it, that's really focusing on the technical accounting issues. And once some of those get sorted out, and it's going to take a few years, it sounds as if, then some of the political issues, which are very, very difficult, will also be addressed. Who knows, maybe in 5 years, the U.S. and China, who would be two very interesting partners in such a conversation, will be at a WTO ministerial, and they'll sort of sort out some of their differences on embedded carbon issues.
Yes, I'd like to respond as well to the woman from Cambridge. It's an interesting question. You know, we organized, in my previous incarnation, I ran something called the International Institute for Sustainable Development. And at the Bali COP, which was about 2008, I think, the Indonesian government asked us if we would help them to organize a meeting of trade ministers on the side of the Bali conference. Everybody thought that was a terrible idea, it would never happen, et cetera. And we got about 20, including the USTR, the Secretary General of the WTO, the Secretary General of UNCTAD, the Chinese. It was very interesting. And it was terra incognita for most of these ministers. They'd never heard of, well, they knew of climate change. They thought it had very little relevance to trade. And they got fascinated by it as the discussion came along. It was a very informal, off-the-record discussion. And we had hoped that this had become sort of part of the furniture at the COPs, but never another one was held. And I think it's not a bad idea to actually bring together ministers responsible for climate change and ministers responsible for trade, briefly, not for 17 days or anything else, but just basically to exchange ideas, because as I was saying before, my conversation with Ambassador Grosser was, he said, you know, half the climate negotiators think the WTO is a kind of 800-pound gorilla lurking in the corner, which will stop them from doing anything because they know very little about WTO rules. And the other way is the same thing. I mean, we are the International Center for Trade and Sustainable Development. That's the sort of thing we do. That's why we're organizing this symposium. But there's a long way to go before there's a higher degree of mutual understanding. I think as the climate agreement starts to bite, there will be more and more trade issues will arise. I mean, this, as countries start to really take this seriously, there will be a complete restructuring of the global energy industry. There's nothing more fundamental than that, and it's got to be that fundamental. So I think you're right. I think it's important to have these discussions now so that we don't run into each other later. On the embedded carbon question, I spend part of my time at the University of Ottawa, and we've done more work on the BC carbon tax than anybody else. And I'm not, if you're talking about industries shifting, I expect you're talking about cement, because BC doesn't have any high carbon industries other than cement. And cement's a special case. You can't move it very far. So basically, it's coming from the United States, which is 70 miles away. I don't think there's a, I'd love to see if you have anything else, but I've not seen anything else that indicated a major shift of high carbon industries out of British Columbia. There is now a major debate in the province about the export of LNG, and liquefied natural gas takes a lot of energy to liquefy. I mean, you have to compress it. And the province is now having a debate about whether or not it could actually license big LNG plants for export to Asia without at the same time blowing the top off its carbon targets. And it is possible, but it's a very tricky issue. But that will be something that one will see, that for the major energy exporters like Canada, trying to fit within a carbon tax is going to be extremely difficult. It's going to be very challenging.
So thank you, David. And I'll ask Dr. Gimiri to make some concluding remarks. So just before handing over, I'd like to thank all of you for bearing with us. I know we're running a bit late and we all have drinks to go to. So thank you very much. And thank you to all the speakers. Dr. Gimiri.
Thanks, Edith. I promise that I don't want to keep you long here. It has been a rich discussion with also contribution from you. And thanks for that. I don't want to summarize the discussion, it's huge. Just wanted to enumerate four key messages that I want to take from this conversation. One is the question of, it is important to decouple trade and economic prosperity from climate change. The relation between trade, economic development, climate change is clear. For the first time, I think a comprehensive quantification exercise was undertaken by the Stern Review 10 years back, 2006. Lord Stern has calculated the economic cost, quantified the economic cost of climate change, and has alarmed us the possibility of reduced GDP figures also. Now that we are taking actions, the international community is taking actions, and as was mentioned, the Paris Agreement was not necessarily about an agreement on climate change. It also is an agreement about investment, which clearly shows action on climate change have positive contributions to economic development. So it is not always that economy is a problem in terms of climate change, but there are also positive relationships, and we need to recognize that. The second question is, the multilateral regime does work, which the climate Paris Agreement has shown. So there needs to be further efforts on this. And we now see hope that even the Doha Development Agenda could have some life in it. And the example from Paris gives some hope that the international system does work in getting the positive relationship between climate change and the economy. Third message, to me at least, while these international conventions and agreements take place and there is always a time lag in them, Paris Agreement has taken place after 5 years, Copenhagen was a failure. DDA, the Doha Development Agenda, is still struggling for life. So we need to issue that. But in the meantime, the international community can take smaller steps, which contribute to the larger agenda. And an example we saw in the International Technology Partnership. So this initiative tries to promote partnership in terms of technology transfers between actors around the globe. And we don't necessarily have to see the big international agreements on providing some support towards this. So these small steps by different actors at an international level do help, and we should also be promoting these. And finally, and have in also with reference to your question, the last question, the political economy of the use of carbon-friendly technologies. I give an example of this. Chinese solar panels, you might be aware of that, Chinese solar panels have faced anti-dumping measures in Australia, in the USA, in Brussels. So the three countries, it is not always that you support anything just because it is renewable. That doesn't happen because the political economy of these things is different. So these three countries, all advocates of climate friendly technology, climate resilience, and so on, they have imposed or taken actions towards anti-dumping measures. Taking anti-dumping measures against these processes. In the meantime, Australia has withdrawn its case, and the other countries are still trying to impose these measures because there are other interests involved. So in relation to the discussion about climate change, we also need to think about other issues that might influence the interests of different stakeholders, especially stakeholders among the powerful countries. And in the WTO, you said, because they have taken these measures because the WTO system does allow these to happen. But we see some progression also within the WTO system because apart from the WTO rules and regulations, et cetera, the WTO case law is also something which is emerging. And we've seen in the dispute settlement system within the WTO, there are in some cases the judgment has gone in favor of energy friendly technologies, regardless of what was written in the rule book. Dispute settlement systems members there have taken a progressive step. So we have to see both sides, the text of the WTO and the emerging WTO case law, which has sometimes been seen as progressive. So it's all a question of how the system evolves, and the system is evolving. But overall, there is a better recognition of these issues, that climate-friendly technologies should be supported, even if there have been some cases against them. So it is not a yes or no answer. It's all perhaps. It might be projected. I think that's all I wanted to say on these four key messages. Thank you very much for your attention, and it's great to see this size of audience still remaining, even if we are approaching the evening. Thank you very much.